Conference about creating furries with foreseeable biotechnologies. It's a follow-up on my previous conference done last year at Eurofurence, and will mainly give you new technologies and new information. So the outline of my talk will be quite simple, introducing the subject, the basis on the science on the subject, and then dealing about the three types of furries we can create, from a human, from an animal, and from both. So first, just to be sure, my definition of furry is quite broad. It's about an hybrid creature with features both animal and humans. But can include cat girls, intelligent animals, talking animals, and in between. Show that we can have three points of access to create a furry. We will start from the human with tissue engineering, start from the animal, or start from both with cameras. So first, a little basic. So the first technique that can be used to create furries is tissue engineering. It means to use stem cells to grow new organs that don't exist normally. Stem cells are a very special kind of multipurpose cell that can multiply indefinitely and create special tissues of almost any kind. If you use stem cells to create a new organ, it will be fully compatible with the patient from which the stem cell originates. So no problem of rejections, no need to take drugs, etc. Two techniques can be used to build organs. Either you use a scaffold made of collagens and of protein on which the stem cell will put and grow, or you can print an organ layer by layer, like with a printer. Simply, you put the stem cell in the cartridge and you scan the surfaces to get your layer done correctly with your design. The second important technique to use is genetic engineering. You tinker the genetic code to obtain what you want. Well, the basis of genetic engineering is to modify DNA, a molecule that is present in the nucleus of almost every of our cells that allow to build an organism, is the code to build an organism, and it can be modified externally. So you have several genes, 30,000 genes that code for proteins. Say which genes you are looking at. Exons that are in blue, that's the coding part of the gene that will be translated into a protein. Introns in red are the non-coding part that can be transcribed into protein in other circumstances. And enhancers will control the way the protein will be produced in which amount. In our case, we have to deal with the way a gene will be expressed in the organism. You have one gene, while we create one protein that will be used in one cell. But the advantage is that it's not the only mechanism. You can have also what we call aux gene, high-level genes, that will create protein that help to regulate the expression of other genes, etc., etc., with a gene cascade. And that means that one gene could control a large part of the structure of an organism. And so we could use that to rebuild a leg or a tail. The last part is a very recent technique, developed in 2010, but very promising, that allow to control neurons and nerves with both light and genes. The principle is that you use a gene coding for an oxide, a light-sensitive ion channel, that will be integrated into neurons, and when you shine the neurons with the appropriate light, it will open the ion channel, activate the neurons, and get locked down. There are several advantageous variations to this technique. First, you can precisely select which group of neurons you want to activate or deactivate because you inject just where you want. You can activate a gene with some kind of opsins, but you could also deactivate other neurons with other kind of opsins. You can do both off, on, off, on. The effect, depending on the opsin, can last between 10 milliseconds and half an hour. The wavelength of the light to excite the opsin can vary between the red and the blue, so you can have the same group of neurons that can be activated with red light, deactivated with blue light, and you can also tie the opsin to cellular pathways in order to do other things that simply activate or deactivate neurons. You can, for example, activate the production of vitamin C in the body with light, something that is not normally possible in humans. So that's it for the basis that will be used in my presentation. So now we'll start with human basal furries because that's generally what you want. There's first about physical modification, about enhancing the sensors, and a request about genetic transformation. First, the principle of a human basal furry, for me at least, is to graft, to put additional organs like tail or muzzle with surgery on an existing human adult to give him the appearance that we want. We can use tissue engineering and 3D printing to obtain that. And last time, I said that there's quite useful technologies that already exist or are in development for this part, but they are all separate. We have to put them together to obtain a correct result. It's something that will be quite difficult. And the final appearance is not really mastered at this time. We can only do a generic, foxy-like being. The first thing to know is that building new organs and grafting them on an existing body is really difficult because we are talking about very complex organs. Here, for example, we have the approximate number of bone, nerves, and muscles needed for a tail and a muscle. So imagine you have to graft this organ, you have to create this organ from scratch and then graft it. So that's not going to be easy. And the second part is that the surgery to attach the new organ on the face, on the coccyx, is not an easy task. For example, for attaching your face, well, you have an operation that will last almost a whole day. You have to connect your mandible, the new mandible to the old one, and all the nerves are to be correctly put on the new facial muscles to get a correct expression. Another problem that we have for the moment is that we don't know really how to supply nutrients to an organ that we are trying to grow. If they are very thin, like a bladder, it's quite possible. But if they are relatively bulky, we have necrosis at the center because we don't have enough nutrient and blood that can get inside the organ. So we had to create a capillary organ. And I found a way to do that with cotton candy. In fact, the advantage is that the sugar fiber of the cotton candy have approximately the same diameter and connectivity of the biological capillaries. The way to do that is you create cotton candy, but don't cut much. You encase the cotton candy in the gel containing the stem cells and growth factor. Put the block into hot water to dissolve the sugar, the fiber of the cotton candy, creating open channel into the block. And when you connect it on the supply nutrient pipe, you have a capillary network that is containing all the new organs that will grow. So no, you have your nutrient supply very correct. Well, it's a one-off technique, for this kind of do-it-yourself system. But in fact, it can be applied to 3D printing. We can print arteries and vessels, blood vessels, with a sugar-based solution to obtain this kind of structure. You can put blood in it without any problems. You can also create with 3D printing action getting graft that will help nerves to grow from your body to the new organ that need to be innerved. And then you can also create bones with granulate made of the same kind of materials as the natural bones. And here you have an example of a jaw, of a part of a jaw made with this kind of granulate. You see, it's quite fine in terms of printing. So we can now 3D print arteries, muscles, nerves, and bone. So we have almost all we need to print a complete organ in one go. But there's more outlandish than that. There's a few doctors that are trying to create wings, generally from the arm or from dorsal wings. You have Professor Rosen from the Darmstadt Engineering School, also nicknamed Dr. Daedalus, and Dr. Poe, that are trying to create this kind of wing, so that bat-like underarm wings. The main problem is that if you get this procedure to work, you lose at least 3 fingers. So you lose a lot of dexterity. So that's all for physical modification. It's already quite all. There's the possibility of enhancing the senses to get senses more like an animal. But what is enhancing? Normally we say that it's going above normal capabilities, but define normal. Well, my definition is for every individual, you have several traits that are several levels for each one of us. But the level is between 0 and 100% of all the capabilities of the world population we are studying. Generally, since they are generally independent this threat tend to obey the Gauss curve. And enhancing means that we are going above the normal range of 1 plus or minus 1 standard deviation from the normal. So it's not forcibly a superpower. It's going above what we normally can do. But there's limits, psychological limits. When you are trying to enhance a threat that is not fundamental to self, like the capacity of attention, memory, basic memory, almost 50% of people will be willing to enhance that. But when you are talking about fundamental traits like empathy, kindness, the percentage of approbation plummet. But first thing, enhancing the sense of smell, because, well, dogs have a very big nose, very good nose. To get that, we have to stimulate one part of the brain, the oncus in yellow, that is part of the limbic system. We can obtain a tremendous sense of smell if you do that, but it will also modify the emotional sensibility of a person. Three techniques have been used for obtaining that. I've told about them last year. They are more or less recent. The first one is deep brain stimulation with electrodes deep in the brain to stimulate one group of neurons. This was already done in the 50s by a Spanish neurologist, and something that I've done give rise to the conspiracy theory for the microchips. But this technique is efficient but extremely invasive. So that's a problem. The second one is drugs, because sometimes drugs can result into a sensorial enhancement. They are not reliable at all, but they are quite effective, and the effect can last quite long. The main testimony said that people that suffer from hyperosmia will get the ability to identify people by their odor without seeing them, or they can identify emotions by odor. And the last technique is what we call transcranial magnetic stimulation. This principle is you have a coil above the brain, outside of the brain, but we put an electrical current, a magnetic pulse, that will generate an electrical current just inside the brain that will excitate or de-excitate neurons. The main advantage is it's a totally non-invasive technique. Nothing in the brain going. So, last year I talked about using this technique to enhance the sense of smell. The first study I found was about helping Parkinson patients who have lost their sense of smell to recover it. They claimed that they got that in 80% of the case, and that the enhancement lasted at least 5 years. But reading more carefully the study, I found several large problems. First one, the doctors that were applying the procedure know when they were applying the active procedure and the fake procedure to get a comparison. Problem is that it gave rise to the problem of a confirmation bias. And also, the other problem is that the fake procedure was not exactly identical to the active procedure, so the patient itself could know that they were applying one or the other. You even have a confirmation bias for the patient. Methodologically, it's garbage. And another problem is that there was no focus on which region of the skull was useful when to stimulate to obtain the result. In any way, the indication seemed that they merely enhanced the threshold of activation for the remaining neurons in the nose. So it's just augmenting the volume on the IFE channel, rather than using an equalizer to broaden your sense of smell. So, result? Fail! Yeah. Well, but we can use another technique to stimulate the mucus. Use optogenetics. If you inject opsine in the mucus and then shine a light on it, you can stimulate it. The main problem is that you have to get an optic fiber in your brain. It's as invasive as the brain nectar. So, it's not very good at it. But we can circumvent this problem with work done in the University of Taipei to use specially genetically modified magnetic bacteria to circumvent the thing. The principle was that bacteria can infiltrate cells near the neurons, produce magnetofluorophores on their surface, but will emit light when they are submitted to varying magnetic fields. That means that you but with the antenna near the brain and the electromagnetic field we reach the zone where you have the magnetofluoral force, this magnetofluoral force will emit light and this light will activate the opsin. You have nothing inside your brain. It's all external, it's all non-invasive. So it's quite interesting technique to circumvent the need to use an optic fiber inside the brain. And you could also use the bacteria to transfer the opsin gene inside the neuron in parallel to create the magnetofluorophore. So you need only one injection into the brain to get the thing working. So well, you could have your technique to get an enhancement of the sense of smell. There also the possibility to enhance our sense of vision, mainly night vision. In most animals, in most nocturnal animals, they have what we call a tapetum, a mirror-like membrane in blue on this schema, that are behind the retina and allow the light to shine twice in the retina, increasing the amount of light that is converted into electricity for the optic nerve. We don't have that, but there's possibility to circumvent this absence, injecting an opsin into the eye of blind mice to restore their vision. Normally, the retina is composed of three layers of cells. Photoreceptive layer, made of cones and rods. The bipolar layer, that will sum the input of the previous layer. And the ganglion layer, that will amplify the signal. Normally, in normal mice, you shine the light, you get a signal. With this kind of blind mice, they don't have any photoreceptive cell. So, no signal. And then you inject an opsin into their bipolar cell, and up, you get a signal again. So you can restore vision. In fact, as visible on this diagram, you have a classical labyrinth where the exit is indicated by a powerful light. And normal mice can do this labyrinth in 5 seconds, blind mice in 30 seconds, but the treated mice can be as good as the normal mice in height light intensity, and the result is stable for at least several months. So I think we are going for clinical trials to get this technique to work on humans for restoring vision for some kind of blindness. But we can use that, for converting human bipolar cell into a second layer of photoreceptive cells in our retina to get an active tapetum. So you can have a better night vision. So that's it for sensor enhancement. And now for a request I was bugged with from several months. Is it possible to create a furry from a human with genetic therapy? My response, wait a lot. Because we have to replace or change a lot of high level genes in our genome to get this to work. It's extremely risky and difficult because with the actual techniques, if you get don't get the insertion correctly, you get the new gene to implant it with another gene, deactivate it, and if it's a gene that normally control suppress the growth of cancer, you are screwed. So the possibility is there to use what we call a human artificial chromosome. The name cell, it's a new chromosome carrying all the new genes, but we don't have to insert genes into our existing genome. In fact, an artificial chromosome is like a genetic live CD. We can custom build it to get what we want. You can control finally when it is activated and O. So well, here is the very backbone of this chromosome. So you need first a gene to activate the chromosome at the right time, then a series of genes, a small gene called T-rex, that will help to silence, to switch off existing gene in the human genome, the same amount of gene, animal genes, to replace the human gene that we have switched off. We have to use several transitional factors to transform the cells where the chromosome is active into stem cells that will be able to rebuild our organs from the inside. Then we have to use two genes, like a NOR gate, so that the output of this NOR gate will be on when the two inputs are off, and these inputs are anti-oncogen proteins that normally are present in our cell to prevent the growth of cancer. And the last one is a suicide gene, linked to the NOR gate, that means that if the cell that is trying to transform is going bad, is going to transform to a cancer cell, it's automatically killed. So it's normally could control the risk of growing cancer because of a genetic modification. But there's still a lot of risk. First, if an organ don't work correctly, you get a generalized cancer. So you are dead in a month. Also, the rebuilding will probably lead to life-threatening violation of blood level and calcium and iron, because you are building bones, you are building tissues very fast. The transformation, so if you don't control correctly the gene, you can get an overshoot where the female form is not what we want. We could get a modification for the brain when it could be modified beyond repair. And also the artificial chromosome is probably not stable enough to be active during all the time for the transformation, because I think that still will need 1 or 2 years. So in conclusion, so far I think that this possibility of genetic transformation will remain science fiction for at least 40 years until we have the knowledge and the know-how to get it work safely and on the first try. So, well, too bad. Well, that's all for human basal furries. No, animal basal furries. Another very promising possibilities. There, we use genetic engineering to modify the brain and the larynx of an animal to give him a few human-like abilities and shared cognition, possibility to speak mainly. Previously, I found that it's a lot more promising that human basal furries, at least for a mid-term research program. We know a lot of the genes, human genes, that can be used, but the exact result is difficult to predict because nobody has tried before. And probably there's engineered animals will probably not be accepted easily into the human society. So here is the list of the 4 genes I treated last year, mainly dealing with the way the brain is developed during pregnancy, development also of larynx and lungs. And we are now 4 more genes to treat. First one, LHX2. It's a high-level gene that it's used in the brain to select the identity of the neurons and where they will grow. As you can see on this picture, this gene will make the cells, the neurons, migrate from the proto-cortex to the neocortex. In the upper level, you have the view of the mouse brain, normal mouse brain with LHX2 that is working, and the lower row you have the same mouse brain but when LHX2 is inactivated. You see that a lot of the neurons have not worked. They are not in the neocortex. They are still where they are divided in the first try. So we can get a bigger brain if you use the human version of the gene on an animal. The second possibility is a gene that is present in human in 3 variants. Normally, animals are only the first variant, variant A. We've got the variant C, the duplicate. It's human-specific, and we get it about 2.4 million years ago during the transition between Australopithecus and Homo habilis. It was in one of the big genes in human evolution. It inhibits the original version, the A version, and it increases the density of neurons in the neocortex, as you can see in red in comparison to the black curve. And it also increases the length of the connection of each neuron to each other. You see the dendrites are at a lot longer, and also the axon. But more connectivity means a more efficient brain, a more performant brain. Next slide is a little graphic. Here we have beta-catenin is a protein that is used in cell adhesion and neural division. If you surexpress it, here you have a normal mice as A, and B you have the air-onset mice with surexpression. You get a volume, a brain volume multiplied by 3, with a lot more folding, cortical folding. So we have the pinky and the brain gene. And the last gene is more mundane. In fact, it's the human gene for our red photopigment. If you inject that gene into mice, well, they get a third photopigment. they can see just like us, with four colors. So at least it will make ancient animals to see like us, to experiment the world like us. It made the communication between us and them a lot easier. So that's all for the genes to modify or to inject. So we have 8 genes possible. Now we need to know how we'll transfer the genes to the animal. We have 3 techniques. First technique, somatic cell transfer. It's in fact cloning. Classical cloning, you get 2 cells. You replace the nucleus of one cell with the nucleus of the other, and you make perfect cloning. This technique is already used to produce transgenic fluorescent puppies. So it's a proven technique. You can insert the gene where you want in the genome. The main problem is the success rate is extremely low, and most of the clones have both defects. Another possibility is sperm-mediated gene transfer. That means that you get the foreign DNA into sperm cells to be integrated in their nucleus. It's a very easy technique that can be done in a very small apparatus. The success rate of transfer is really high. The main problem is that you cannot really control where you insert the new gene into the genome of the sperm cells. So you could get a quite unpredictable result. And the last one is testis-mediated gene transfer, where instead of injecting the DNA into sperm cells, you inject it into the testicles. The advantage there is that you will get the cells that produce sperm cells to get the gene. So they will produce sperm with the gene. The advantage there is that you can use the same techniques, precise gene insertion technique that for cloning, but you get the success rate of sperm gene transfer. The main problem for Cedric is that you have to sort the sperm cells after ejaculation to get the one that got the genetic modification, and the other problem that the animal gets germlines modified. That means if it's released in the wild, it could produce genetically modified offspring. And that's something that ethically is more problematic. Given all these pros and cons for these techniques, I have chosen testis gene transfer, because it's, for me, the most efficient one of them. Then we have to precisely replace the animal gene with the human one to get a benefit result. We can do that with what we call Zeng finger nuclease, that are protein that can bind to the DNA at a precise location, cut it, and permit to insert the new DNA inside. The principle is quite simple. You have your zinc finger protein that's zipping along the DNA. It's up where it's binding, at the precise location where you want it to bind. It's cut the DNA, and then you can insert a new gene, or you can deactivate an existing gene. So that's a quite precise method. So we have new genes. We know how to transfer them. We know how to precisely insert them. So it's already quite. And our last part is about chimera, creating a hybrid, a literal hybrid of human and animal cells. But it's viable. The principle is quite simple. You create 2 embryos, one human, one animal. You fuse them together, and then you obtain an hybrid creature that is a patchwork of tissue from one of these parents and one of the other. So, for example, you have what we call a goat sheep, with part sheep, part goat. Last time I found that it's proven to work with parent species that are similar, like this one, but it's uncertain if they are viable if you use human and dog, for example. And you probably will need to use a human surrogate mother to get them to grow correctly and develop. So, it is possible in primate, yes. In fact, chimeras, at least intraspecific chimeras, exist in all mammals, even in humans. You can have people that have 2 lines of cells inside their body. And in this case, the main technique that worked was the last one. You agglomerate embryos and you create a mosaic chimera that can have up to 6 cell line origin, 6 embryos in one. But the problem is, if you use a human embryo and an animal embryo, the divergence in terms of development during the pregnancy could lead to severe deformities. Like you have an arm of a dog and the rest is human. it won't work very well. There's also a point of the viability of these chimeras. There's not a lot of data about the viability of this kind of chimeras, because obviously there's a lot of ethical problems to make pregnancy to make a pregnancy occur. But we can focus on another kind of chimera, like the nuclear chimera. It's where you have an egg from one species with a nucleus from for another. And in this case, the technique is similar to cloning. We have the same kind of issues. And now you have the results. It was done, we started with egg, the buffalo egg, and the nucleus was from another species. And now you can see the further the species, the lower the chance of success. And in some cases, it doesn't work at all. So we know that in some cases, we could not have nuclear chimeras. And human-animal chimeras, because they are too dissimilar to get it worked. But there's also a paradox about science regulation for chimeras. When you want to outright ban them, no research on that, people are outraged. But they are outraged because they say, what are you legislating on that? They also blame the local politician about it, of course. And there's also inevitable burns. But when you allow research about chimeras with strict regulation, like in Great Britain, when you can obtain that very precise guidelines, and you have to destroy the embryo after 14 days after conception, you get the opposite reaction. Frankenstein, of course. Forcibly is completely different from the original novel, but they have only seen the movies. Of course, also the doomsayers and the inevitable conspiracy theorists. Seriously. Well, but so to conclude this talk, so for animal-based furries, there are numerous techniques that could be used to create them, but you need to put them together to work, and it's a lot of research needed to get that gene-based transformation. Still science fiction for 40 years. So to get something to work, we need more specification to know where we are eating and what kind of food people want. Because creating a cat girl is a lot easier than creating a full kitchen, for example. For chimeras, they are probably non-viable. It's an ethical hurdle, so don't worry about it. We'll let that for over. And the last one for animal-based furries, it's a more promising because most of the theoretical aspect of this clear. The technology needed are generally already developed and are quite affordable, and we are less problem in terms of ethics if we do that correctly. And as a result, I have there the first draft of an animal uplift protocol to create a genetically humanized dog. And I'll seek the help of geneticists to get it to review it and see if it can work like this. So thanks for your attention, and we can start the question and answer session just after I started my microphone. Thank you.